We, as I had said earlier, as soon as we have more to announce, we will ask for you to come. So, sandali lang, we'll be debriefing. We, as I'm sure you know, nakakatanggap na ako na mga congratulatory messages from different heads of states. Nakausap ko na si, ang unang nakatawag sa amin ay yung US, the President Joe Biden, and China, President Xi. Nakausap ko na yung also the Japanese Prime Minister Kishida. I even spoke to the outgoing Prime Minister of Australia, PM Morrison, who just went through an election also. So, marami na talagang nangyayari, marami na talagang we are already being recognized. This new administration is being already recognized. Mukha namang walang problema sa recognition. Maybe the comfortable margin that we enjoyed during the election is has a part to play with that. In connection of that, today I met with three ambassadors. The ambassador of South Korea, the ambassador of Japan, the ambassador from India, and now the head of station of the United States, where we were able to discuss many of the things that how we are going to handle the next few years in terms of our relationships with the different countries. Ang aking lang lagi pinapaalala sa kanila, sinasabi ko, palagay ko, sa pandemyang ito, ang recovery ng lahat natin ay hindi kakayanin ng kahit isang bansa, kahit gano'ng kayaman. Kailangan the partnerships will be the one that will bring us through. Keep the global economy at least as stable as is possible and will give us the opportunities for us to take advantage of the opening of the global economy. So I think that we were all in agreement that that is going to be the situation. Specifically in Japan, with the Japanese ambassador, we spoke about some of the ODA projects that JICA ODA that possibly we can pursue. At marami siyang ipinakita sa amin na mga possibilities in terms of infrastructure, in terms of transportation infrastructure, in terms of the usual horizontal infrastructure, and also of employment, where he would like to see an increase, Japan would like to see an increase of employment of Filipinos in Japan. So that we will pursue that those opportunities further. With the ambassador of South Korea, napag-usapan namin yung IT, digital communication, because South Korea is still considered to be one of the best in the world when it comes to IT. And I said, kung sana matulungan mo kami diyan. At pinag-usapan din namin with the South Korean ambassador, napag-usapan din namin yung offer nila at yung nakapunta na rito ng mga expert na nuclear power para tignan ang Bataan Nuclear Power Plant para makita kung ano ba ang maaring gawin. Pwede pa bang ituloy o kailangan na magtayo ng bago? What are the things that we will have to do? So, binuhay namin ulit ang diskusyon na yon. Although they have come before, we will now study their recommendations and their findings, and we will see if it can still apply. Because as we have been talking about all through the campaign, isa sa pinakamalaking problema is the supply of power. If we are going to industrialize post-pandemic, we are going to go through rapid industrialization, then the power sector must be ready for that. And the problem in the power sector is that malaki ang lead time. Kahit na siguro yung pinakamaliit na planta, 3 years yan. Minimum, 3 to 5 to 7 years. But kahit na hindi namin hindi aabutan ng administrasyon ko, we still have to start somewhere. So we spoke about that, and some of the other security concerns for the region. And siyempre, North Korea is a continuing concern to South Korea, and the stability in our area is something that we had also discussed with the ambassador from India. We hit upon he had three very interesting programs that they are instituting in India that I think might be applicable in the Philippines, and we again agreed to go into these different areas in greater detail. Number one, of course, is agriculture. We have a lot, we can learn a lot, especially from India, not only in the techniques of agriculture, but also in the protection of farmers, and how to bring the age, average age of the farmers down from what it is now. Nababasa ko 57, 50, 56, 57 ang average age ng ating mga magsasaka. At walang pumapasok ng mga kabataan. And one of the solutions that was proposed is that it will, kung gawin nating high-tech yung ating agriculture, magiging interesting para sa mga mas bata. Because with the new technologies, we will need young people anyway. So we started talking about that and the protection of the farmers. I also, because it is one of the conclusions we arrived at during and after the pandemic, after the first hit of the pandemic, yung gamot. And we know that India is one of the largest manufacturers of generic drugs. And I think I said if we could go into partnership para magkaroon ng production dito sa Pilipinas, turuan nyo kami what is the manufacturing technology, what are the necessary things that have to be put in place. Is there new legislation? Would we have to put up a new agency, or we will have to do training of those of yung mga nasa atin na tao? But in the end, to be able to provide at least the basic, yung mga basic lang ng mga gamot, na dito na nang gagaling. Marami na tayong ginagawa pero marami pa rin kulang. And kaya naman siguro, I have no doubt na yung ating mga manufacturers dito, kaya naman nilang gawin yan. Pero we will get advice because may experience ang India. Kaya siguro naman marami silang maipapakita sa atin. Titignan natin kung babagay dito sa Pilipinas, baka maka-adapt tayo, and we will also be able to pursue that. The other very interesting area that we talked about with the Indian ambassador was their programs in India for microfinancing. And this is again because of the MSMEs that we are hoping to assist, to bring back, to create more jobs, to bring people back their livelihoods. Meron silang statistic na nagulat kaming lahat, sinabi, 70 pesos pa lang, 70 pesos pa lang, pwede na silang magbukas ng account doon sa kanila. Napakaliit lamang, kaya na nila. So sabi ko, will you please send me material? Because I'm very, very interested in that. Kasi mabusisi ang trabaho na yan. India has always been a pioneer in terms of microfinancing. They have taken it already to this level na kahit ganun lang kaliit ang puhunan mo, pwede ka na magkabanko, pwede ka na magkabank account, pwede ka na maghanap buhay, pwede ka na magnegosyo. And with the American charge, as you can imagine, pagka kausap natin Amerikano, marami talaga kaming pag-uusapan. But primarily, one of the first subjects that we came upon were the assistances that the United States is offering to mitigate climate change in different countries. At very active sila. They want to take a leadership role in the mitigation of the effects of climate change, of global warming. And I said, it is very, that became, nung nakita ko sa brief na yun ang kanilang ginagawa, ay nakita ko kagad kasi napakataas natin, top 3 tayo sa at risk sa climate change. So that's that is immediately of great interest. Security concerns, of course, have always been a big part of our relationship with the United States. But then the additional ang aking sinasabi, it is very well. Of course, we will welcome any assistance for the economy that we can get from the United States. But I think that not only a dependence on aid from the United States, but also in trade not aid. Balik pa rin tayo doon, trade not aid. And so to open the government, the bureaucracy, this administration, to the possibilities of private partnerships, joint venture from the Philippines and with the American. Marami naman tayong history sa ganyan. Marami nang nagbubukas dito na kumpanya na American for a long time now. So that is a well-established route or role that we have the part of our relationship. Siyempre, security concerns, pinag-usapan namin return or the re-signing or the extension of the VFA agreement and how it has to be redefined for the near future with the changing situation around the world, especially in our region. Siyempre, yun ang ating primary concern. So if we talked about some new technologies that might be available to us in terms again of power generation, but which ang usapan talaga nasa climate change. Napunta kasi naman climate change na pupunta yan sa lahat ng sektor eh. Kaya yun ang napunta sa power, napunta sa agri, napunta sa iba't ibang sektor. So that is the extent of my discussions with the ambassadors today, with some of the diplomats that came to see me today. This is not the first time I've met with him. This must be about the second, third, or fourth time already. Dahil nung kampanya pa lang, marami nang pumupunta, nagtatanong, ano ba talagang iniisip mo, ano yung binabalak mo. And this is just to further the discussion so that we get into actual practical detail, hindi lang yung mga vague ideas of what can be done, but really to dig down and to see what can be done, what needs to be done para mag-succeed itong mga program na ito, what do we have to do in the Philippines, what can we expect from our partners around the world. So that's basically it, except for some of, I think, the yung inaantay nyo talaga yung mga appointment.
Yes.
Well, na ano tayo ni ano na on the our friend the incoming DOJ secretary has already announced it himself. So sa segundahan ko na lang siya, that Boying Remulla, I have asked him to join the government as DOJ, the Secretary of the Department of Justice. I think he will be very good. He has, as you know, he has a great many years of experience in government, number one. And what many people do not know is that he's actually a very, very good lawyer. And so I think he will fit very nicely into the DOJ. I guess we can talk about our last meeting already. I had over lunch the former Secretary Laguesma of DOLE and Toots Ople to talk about the labor segment, both DOLE and the new Department of Migrant Workers. So our new My nominee for Dole is going to be the former secretary Laguesma, to return, and we've asked help from Toots Ople to start organize already the Department of Migrant Workers, so that when the time comes that we are mandated to start operations, we are ready. Hindi na tayo mag-a-adjust, hindi na tayo magpapalit. Kaya ang naging concern ko is mahirap naman kung magbabago tayo 2 years from now, babaguhin natin dahil magkakaroon ng migrant worker, Department of Migrant Workers, kung ititigil pa natin ang services bago tayo nag-organize. So sabi ko, para hindi matigil ang functions, ay ngayon pa lang, umpisahan na nating pag-isipan kung ano ang gagawin natin para pagdating ng panahon ay mabilis na the Department of Migrant Workers from the day one will immediately be operational and performing its function. That's really my general policy sa lahat na ito, is to fix policy as early as now, so that when the time comes that we are giving now our nominations to the CA, ay mabilis na ang magiging proseso. At kahit na hindi pa ma-confirm yung mga iba, hindi pa natapos ang confirmation process ng mga iba, ay ang mangyayari ay marami na tayong naintindihan na ng mga tao natin, the cabinet, the secretaries, and the rest of government, kung ano yung kailangan gawin, what is expected, what the timetable has to be, so that we can immediately start work as soon as the term of the next administration begins. I have also tapped an old friend who also was formerly in this position, Arce Balisacan, who was our former NEDA, and I've asked him to return to NEDA. I've worked with him extensively in the time that I was governor. We have very similar thinking in that regard. Kaya malakas ang loob ko. I know he's very competent. I know his policies are policies that will be to the betterment of our country, and for employment, for the development of the economy. Nag-usap kami ng ilang oras at mukha namang tumutugma ang aming pag-iisip tungkol sa approach natin dito sa mga darating na ilang taon when it comes to the economic managers. I know that, siyempre, ang punot-dulo talaga na susunod na administrasyon is the economy. Kaya alam ko yan, inaabangan na talaga ninyo. Allow me in maybe a few more days for me to be able to announce formally who will be part of the, well, the labor sector is going to be very much part of any redevelopment and recovery of the economy. So that's part of it. NEDA, obviously. Sa NEDA, having come from governor, eh sabi ko dapat ibalik natin yung tunay, yung primary function ng NEDA. NEDA, you have to remember, is the National Economic Development Authority. And the process has always been that the provincial development councils will forward their recommendations to the regional development council, which will forward their recommendations to NEDA. Hindi na nasunod yun. Kailangan natin maibalik, because again, being a proponent of local government, we need to hear from local governments so that what we do at the national level is relevant to the needs and the concerns of local government. So that's it for now. I think that's enough to be getting on with. We're working very hard on the other departments, and dahan-dahan naman we are beginning to fill the positions. I still have to talk to them some of our proposed nominees. And we have to understand na nagkakasundo kami sa polisiya. Kasi kung di naman sila mag-agree, eh, mahirap naman masyado yun. So we will continue to discuss with them. And should they agree, umpisahan na namin ang mga planning para diyan. So I wanted, technically talaga, dapat after proclamation itong mga announcement na ito. Pero I know na maraming hindi na makapag-antay dahil nga napaka-importante ng itong mga appointment na ito. But allow me the luxury of a few more days and we will be able to announce more. At the moment, siyempre nakaabang kami sa canvassing. My best information is that the canvassing will proceed rapidly, and I told the speaker and the leadership of the House and of the Senate that I'm on call. Kung matapos sila, kahit anong oras, kahit hating gabi, I would be happy to go there to be proclaimed. So that's what we are busy with now. That also explains to you bakit ako naka-Amerikana. Dahil nga, mga taharap ko, ambasador nga, na ibang look namin dito sa headquarters at hindi na kami nangangampanya at we are now back in the office, working in the office. So I'll leave that with you for now. Well, I'll take a few.
Sa inauguration ko, Mr. President, are we going to help it sa grandstand po since parang
hindi kaya because nga na may ospital eh. Eh, ginagamit pa eh. Hindi naman natin pwedeng ilipat yun. Kailangan pa doon.
Ito yata ng Manila government and even the DPWA Secretary Roger Mercado parang sa Gina sinabi niya na.
No, I don't think there's any need to go to that. Yun lang, we're now looking for an alternative.
So out na po yung grandstand?
I think for now, unless something will change radically, we cannot use Quirino Grandstand. I would have, mas maganda para sa akin, gusto ko doon dahil yan ang tradisyon eh. Pero marami talagang pinilitan yung pandemic. Wala tayong magagawa.
Sir, under your administration, will the Philippines participate in the Indo-Pacific Economic Framework?
Yes, we talked about that.
Can you discuss more?
Yes, we are very much involved. We are very much involved and we are considered very much an important member of that aggregation. So some of the elements of the Indo-Pacific Regional Treaty are going. We spoke about with the different ambassadors, most specifically with the American Chargé. So yes, we'll be involved in that.
Sir, House Majority Leader has said that.
I'm sorry.
House Majority Leader Ron Wallace has said that.
Okay, I'm sorry. I'm really.
Hello, sir. House Majority Leader Ron Wallace has said that a stimulus measure is among your top priority legislation.
Yeah.
For the incoming Congress, sir. Sir, may we know, sir, if you think that the government still has funds to fund another stimulus package, and then, sir, given that the 90% of the 2022 budget has already been dispersed to various agencies.
Yes, there are slight differences because although it has been disbursed, not all of it has been spent. So meron pa tayong breathing room, pero konti na lang. And so that's why we will have to look to the new budget, the budget for 2023, which is presently being written. We have to look at that to find sufficient funds for the things that we want to do. Kasi talaga, basically, move some public expenditure away from non-investment expenditures to more investment-led expenditures. Again, to revitalize, to really retool the economy.
So you're also open to open selling government assets such as Malaya and a portion of Manila Bay as proposed by Congressman Salcedo and
I'm always very wary of selling government assets. So as a matter of principle, I'd rather not. So, yes.
Sir, just a follow-up. How do you think the Philippines will benefit from the Indo-Pacific Economic Framework?
Well, it's going to be, because now, as I said, the survival and the stability of the global economy or even just the regional economy is going to depend on the partnerships we make with other countries. And that's why that's going to be very important. We have to open as much of the economy as we can to trade. And that's where these kind of treaties come in. Okay, thank you. Maraming salamat.